Now, in chapter 39, what we have here is the awful thing that happened. And we are told, and I'm reading now verse 1 of chapter 39, in the ninth year of Zedekiah, king of Judah, in the tenth month, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and all his army against Jerusalem, and they besieged it. And in the 11th year of Zedekiah, the fourth month, the ninth day of the month, the city was broken up. That's important to note. Now I drop down to verse 7. Moreover, he put out Zedekiah's eyes and bound him with chains to carry him to Babylon. We have that statement made, and there are two great truths that are self-evident up to this point. Now, Jerusalem has fallen, and Babylon now has taken it, and the city is destroyed, and the temple is burned. Now, if you want the record of that, if you went over to the 52nd chapter of Jeremiah, that's the last chapter, this is sort of a retrospect. It looks back to what took place. And this evidently was impressed upon the mind of Jeremiah. It says here, verse 4, it came to pass in the ninth year of his reign, in the tenth month, of the tenth day of the month, that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came, he and all his army against Jerusalem, and pitched against it, built forts against it. So the city was besieged until the 11th year of King Zedekiah. You see, he had come really three times against Jerusalem. He took it the first time, and he just put Jehoiachin. Then the second time he came, and Jehoiachin had rebelled. Then he put this man Zedekiah on the throne. He was an uncle, but a young man. But he rebelled, and now he's come for the last time, and he is destroying the city of Jerusalem. And you have the record here in this chapter, which I'm not going to read, but it's a very horrible picture of how he took the city and he carried away captives, certain of the poor of the people and the residue of the people that remained in the city, those that fell away and fell to the king of Babylon and the rest of the multitude. Now some went over to the king of Babylon, and he carried away a great delegation at this time. But the thing that he did here, and it was a thing that is very terrible, he put out Zedekiah's eyes. First of all, he slew the sons of Zedekiah before him. Verse 6 of chapter 39. Then the king of Babylon slew the sons of Zedekiah in Riblah, before his eyes. Also the king of Babylon slew all the nobles of Judah. Verse 7, moreover, he put out Zedekiah's eyes, bound him with chains to carry him to Babylon. That's a frightful picture now that we have here. And this begins what our Lord Jesus called the times of the Gentiles. Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And I insist that though they have the city today, that they are not trodding the old city, that the Gentiles are still actually in control. Most of the holy places there, Israel doesn't have a one of them, except a wailing wall. They've got a wall to go to and weep, and that's all they've got in the old city. But the words of the Lord Jesus are still true. Now the other thing is something that's difficult for this generation to accept. And that is the fact of the judgment of God, that the judgment of God comes upon a nation, it comes upon a family, it comes upon an individual. And for 40 years, Jeremiah had proclaimed the word of Jehovah. He had denounced the sins of the people. He called these people to repentance. And they had not. And God was patient, and his patience deceived them. It enabled the false prophets to say, see, the words of Jeremiah have not come to pass. Now they have come to pass, and it's too late now. You remember? Because that judgment against an evil work is not executed speedily, the heart of the sons of men is in them to do evil. Because God doesn't move hurriedly. Now, I used to think as a boy, and when I was a boy, I was a good boy, but I always got with bad boys. That was my problem. And we used to steal peaches and apples and eggs and watermelons, anything else we could. And I know that one time that I was up in a peach tree, and my, those peaches were nice, and the owner of it, I heard him call my name, and I looked down, and there he was looking up at me. And you know, I felt at that moment that fire would come out of heaven, and God would strike me with a lightning bolt. And after that, every time, remember one time in a watermelon patch, couldn't get through the fence. I got hung up on a barbed wire, and I thought somebody was after me, but there wasn't. It was just a bad conscience. But I felt like any moment that there would come a lightning bolt and just end it all as far as I was concerned, you see. And a great many people today think that because God doesn't move immediately, that means that he's being generous with you. It means that he's not going to do anything. You know, there's an old proverb, at least one of the, I guess it was one of the Greek poets that said it, "The mills of God grind slowly, but they grind exceeding small." And God does let a people go on, and an individual until there comes a time there is no remedy. That's where we come here. And the day that this man Nebuchadnezzar broke into the city, it says here, as we have seen, that he besieged it, and that that day, the ninth month, the city was broken up. From that moment on, it's too late. Now, it's difficult for man to accept that today that God judges. And I want to spend just a moment with this, because some of you are really going to think I'm a square, because this is outmoded today. But I want you to notice a few things and see how outmoded this is. Humanity. Mankind does not like to hear that God is going to judge. And they just can't believe that God ever gets angry. And you find that everywhere. Let me say this. You find it in the New Testament. Now, there are those today that say the God of the Old Testament, he was a God of wrath. But when you come to the New Testament, well, it's altogether different. May I say to you that there's more divine wrath and anger in the New Testament than there is in the Old? Read the 23rd chapter of the Gospel of Matthew and listen to the gentle Jesus speak. And that's what makes it frightful when he says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites." And when you read the book of Revelation and the bowls of wrath are poured out, and there's nothing like that in the Old Testament. So that when you say today that the Old Testament has the God of wrath, the New Testament the God of love, it's almost the other way around. But just happens to be that he's a God of love, and he's a God also of wrath and of anger, and that he punishes sin. And you find here the thing we've mentioned before, the bitter and the sweet. You find divine judgment down by the very side of divine mercy. And the throne of God today, there's a throne of grace and a place to find mercy and help. But that very throne is going to judge this earth someday. And that's what makes it extremely difficult for man to see and understand. Now, the very interesting thing is, not only is it in the New Testament, but you'll find that that is true in nature. Have you ever stopped to think today that you find the anger and judgment of God in nature? Well, if you don't believe it, then I would suggest that you go up to Yosemite Valley, and there's a place called El Capitan, the sheer surface of a rock, several thousand feet high, and step off of it and see what happens. In nature, there are certain laws, and they're inexorable. And my friend, if you obey them and you're good, well, may I say to you that you'll live. But I want to say this to you, if you break them, you're going to die. The man that went to the moon, we think it's such a wonderful feat. It was. But you know what actually happened? They just were using the laws of God, and you know what they were doing? They were obeying them. They didn't break them. They didn't dare break them. When they started out to the moon, they didn't start toward the moon. They start to where it would be when they got there. And they knew it would be there. It wasn't there at the time, but they knew it would be there because that's one of the laws of God. There's movement in this universe, and it follows a certain law and a pattern. And if you ignore it, those fellows would still be out yonder somewhere in space, and they would not be alive. And also, when they got on the moon, they didn't say, well, now let's take off our helmets and run around here and have a lot of fun. They didn't dare do that. They had to recognize that the law of gravity was different there and there was not any air there. And you better obey those laws. If you obey them, you'll live. If you disobey them, you'll die. Who says that? God says that. God is a God of love. And this is where he said, I've loved you with an everlasting love, but you're judged now because you've disobeyed the anger of God and the judgment of God. You don't like it? Then step off of a 10-story building that man makes and you'll find out God has the law of gravitation working there. And he won't revoke it. He won't repeal it. He won't dissolve it to please you. May I say to you, you'll find it's there. Then may I say to you that you not only find this is a revelation of God in nature, and that nature proclaims his vengeance, his anger, and his punishment, but you're also going to find it in human history. Human history does that. All you have to do is walk down through the corridor of time and look at the debris and the ashes and the wreckage of the great civilizations of this world. They testify that he's a God of vengeance, a God of punishment, a God of judgment. And when they turn from high ideals and from a lofty moral plane to base ideals, they go down and they pass off the stage of human history. And it's time some of our intellectuals in this country are beginning to read history aright today, and that God moves in human history. Now, I want to say that I feel like a square saying this, but may I also say to you, I don't feel so bad about it because Jeremiah was a square and the king was pig-headed. Old Zedekiah was pig-headed. And the intellectuals at that day, the sophisticates, the one who thought they knew it all, the ones who had ruled God out, they were stupid. They were stupid, my beloved. So when today I'm called an intellectual obscurantist, I don't know what that is, but whatever it is, it must not be good, and that's what they call me. May I say to you, I don't mind being that because I'm fine. I'm in very good company. Fact of the matter is, I find out God is in this area. Until next time.